As many others before me, I would like to thank Professor Peter Schuster for organizing this wonderful conference and for inviting me. Today I'm going to talk about a man whose name most of you probably never heard. Another forgotten scientist, I wouldn't say hero, like Jan Lucky said yesterday in connection with Albert Gekker, a man who yesterday Professor Arnold Rothenday mentioned, a man who proves that sometimes scientists' careers are not driven by a sort of inner scientific logic, but by external circumstances. The Spanish physicist Arturo Duperrier, he died in 1959, Patrick Blackett wrote in Nature. Professor Arturo Duperrier was distinguished by his pioneer researches into the various cosmic, the variation of cosmic ray intensity with time and with meteorological conditions. He began this work in 1938 when he came to work with me and my cosmic ray colleagues in the physical laboratories of the University of Manchester. He was able to show quantitatively how the observer dependence of the cosmic ray atmosphere intensity on temperature may be an effect due to the decay of moons in the atmosphere. By careful use of meteorological data obtained from various observations, Duperrier was able to locate the average age of the production of moons at about 16 kilometers. He added too that such work demanded the meticulous analysis of great amount of numerical data at which Duperrier was extremely expert. Another proof of the status he acquired in the field of cosmic rays are the reference to his work which appear in classics and reference as Lajos Janowski, Cosmic Rays, a book published in 1948, as you can see here. Duperrier began his studies on physics at Madrid University in October 1913. Compared with what had happened in the past, when physics was in a deplorable situation in Spain, during the 1910s and 1920s, physics has begun to develop significantly in Spain, or better, in Madrid. This was thanks to the efforts of a public institution established in 1907, translation is the Board of the Extension for both Studies and Scientific Research. Besides offering grants to study abroad, La Junta created centers of its own in which advanced research could be done. One of them, established in 1910, was a physical research laboratory. This is not actually the oldest laboratory, but a new one, which opened in 1931 and was built up with the money of the International Educational Board of the Rockefeller Foundation. Those laboratories, the old one, the laboratory and this institute of the National Institute of Physics and Chemistry, were dedicated to physics and chemistry, magnetism, spectroscopy, and physical chemistry. And it was there where Duperrier was initiated to research. His supervisor was a man who was then the most important physicist in Spain, Blas Carrera, the director of the Physical Research Laboratory, as well as professor of electricity and magnetism in Madrid Faculty of Science, a member of the Royal Academy of Science, and an expert in magnetism. Thanks to the quality of his work, in 1928, Cabrera was elected a member of the Commission Scientific International of the Institute International de Physique Sorbonne. Here you can see Einstein during the visit he paid to Madrid in 1923. Behind Einstein is a young Arturo Duperrier. does at Einstein, bright is Blaskavera, the man who I mentioned. Not surprisingly, the Poellau doctoral dissertation, completed in 1924, was dedicated to magnetism, to a ferromagnetic study of water and several solutions of paramagnetic salts. Actually, when we look at the Poellau list of publications, we find that until 1939, a large part of the papers he published, most of them in collaboration, were dedicated to problems of magnetism. Besides those papers, beginning in 1927, he published a number of works dealing with atmospheric physics, the fluctuation of the terrestrial electric field, vertical distribution of the temperature in the atmosphere of the center of Spain, the electric conductivity of Madrid air, are titles of those papers. However, there was one that dealt with cosmic radiation, probably the last one he wrote when in Spain, published in 1937, as a report on the National Meteorological Service entitled The Cosmic Radiation in Madrid and Valencia. The origin of superior meteorological interest had to do with finding a job. There were no paid positions at the Physical Research Laboratory, the National Institute of Physics and Chemistry, and so he applied, as many Spanish physicists did then and later, for a position at the National Meteorological Service, where he entered as assistant in 1921. And he did well in that field of physics as to become, in 1933, the first professor of a newly created chair in Madrid University, a chair dedicated to geophysics. He was, as Arnold Wolfenthal said yesterday, one of those atmospheric electricians who finally, in his case for political reasons, became interested or worked on cosmic ray physics. So far, so good. But the history of Arturo Duperier's contribution to cosmic ray research cannot be understood on such parameters. We need also to take into account the Spanish political history of the 1930s. As you no doubt know, on April 14, 1931, a republic was established in Spain, abolishing the monarchy. Duperier was a Republican, a loyal Republican, or a moderate one, and when as a consequence of the outbreak of the Civil War in 1936, the Spanish government, the Republican government, left Madrid, the capital, and established its premises on Valencia, on the Mediterranean coast, together with other institutions, Madrid University among them. Duperier went there too. Well, in November, went to Valencia in November 36, making public his political opinions in cultural publication of the time together with noted writers. He even participated in some official delegations, as in 1937 when he went to Paris to the inauguration of the Palais de la Découverte. When he returned to Spain, pressed by the rebels, the Republican government had moved to Barcelona, Duperier went there to see. There was no time for the university studies or for doing research at the university. The Madrid campus became about the battlefield. This not a picture of the science faculty, but of the philosophy faculty, but the philosophy faculty, the science faculty was just in front of this this faculty. I said that he went to Paris to Barcelona. However, the situation was such that it was, as I just mentioned, totally impossible to do any scientific research. And Duperrier asked to be permitted to immigrate. Along to that, he left Spain with his family in the spring of 1938 towards England. He and his family arrived in London on May 1938. After 4 days of being there, without no connection whatsoever with any British university or research institution, and knowing that a congress dedicated to the cosmic rays was going to be held in Cambridge, Duperrier decided to attend it. Apparently, this is what his wife, years after, told. During one of the sessions of the congress, a British who was seated to his right asked him, "Are you an Spaniard?" "Yes," answered Duperrier. "New question, follower of Franco?" "Yes." "No." Hearing this, the man to his left intervened, "Are you a sign?" "Yes." "And what are you going to do in England?" "All my interest is to work. I wish to know a professor of name Blackett who worked in cosmic rays." "I am Professor Blackett," was the unexpected answer. In this way, Duperrier made his entrance to the British physics community. Blackett was, Cyrano mentioned yesterday, a Fabian, that is a left-wing socialist, and he hosted many left-wing physicists. It is not surprising, therefore, that he arranged a temporary position for Duperrier in Manchester beginning on June 1939. It was a most fortunate to Duperrier to have such an opportunity. As Blackett, who succeeded William Lawrence Bragg as professor of physics at the university in the autumn of 1937, had created there a major research center for cosmic rays, having at various times visitors such as Ogier, Baba, Rocciolini, Heisenberg, Rossi, and in a more permanent basis, Janosy. Cyrano was there too, as he mentioned yesterday. Duperrier remained in Manchester until the outbreak of the Second World War, where he moved to to London, to Imperial College of Science and Technology, where he set up a cosmic ray recording apparatus prepared at Manchester in a small room near the top of the Royal College of Science building at South Kensington, running it continuously throughout the work and for some years afterwards. That he chose to work on cosmic ray physics was clearly Blackett's suggestion, as Duperrier himself acknowledged during the Guthrie lecture, as we mentioned later on. And the suggestion of Professor Patrick Blackett, he wrote there, undertook in 1939 the study of variation of cosmic ray intensity with time. As a matter of fact, and because he was an alien, a foreigner, a national, a neutral country during the Second during the Second World War, Duperrier was one of the few physicists who kept working on cosmic ray during the war. The investigation on cosmic radiation brought Werner Heisenberg in 1943 in the foreword of a collective work dedicated to cosmic radiation that he edited, the investigation on cosmic radiation had been sharply curtailed by the misfortunes of the time. On the one hand, in most physical laboratories, they have taken second place with respect to other problems. And on the other hand, the failure of the usual channels of communication makes it difficult to obtain information as the result was obtained in other countries. So, in some sense, Duperrier benefited from the war and from being an alien in Krakow. Duperrier's work on cosmic rays dealt with the variation of the intensity of cosmic ray depending on temperature, that is, on the altitude in the atmosphere, an effect that had been observed already in 1935 by Hess, Lafayette, and Steinmaurer. On the basis of that effect, in a paper published in 1938 in Physical Review, Blackett had proposed that such variation could be accounted for in terms of the instability of the meson. The particle that had been proposed by Yukawa in 1935 to explain the short-range nuclear forces. The argument was that if the temperature in the atmosphere of the atmosphere increases without change of pressure, then the mass of air, the span, and the time of travel of the mesons through the atmosphere is increased. So an increase in of the temperature should be accompanied by a decrease of the meson intensity. What Duperrier did was to use more sensitive tests based on the temperature effect, showing that the temperature effect was best accounted for on the assumption that the mesons had originated at a height of 16 kilometers or even higher. The first product of Duperrier research appeared in 1941 in a paper published in the Proceedings of the Royal Society entitled The Seasonal Variation of Cosmic Ray Intensity and Temperature of the Atmosphere. Years after, it was already in London, he published a letter to the editors in Nature, 1942, entitled, you can see here, Cosmic Ray and Magnetic Storms. Early records of the intensity of cosmic ray, he wrote there, have been made in the past year. He paid attention especially to the remarkable changes of cosmic ray intensity associated with a magnetic storm which occurred on March 1, 1941, with one unexplained variation of 12% observed from March 1, his classic conclusion was that from the record of this and other storms, it seems clear that at any rate in these latitudes, there is no simple proportionality between geomagnetic and cosmic rays disturbances. Besides, on August 13, 1942, he observed an unusually rapid increase in the intensity of cosmic rays. From information obtained from the Royal Observatory in Greenwich, he appeared that the magnetic field remained perfectly calm during those days. So he concluded that in order therefore to account for the great influx of particles, it would probably be necessary to assume that they entered the Earth in the form perhaps of a stream superimposed on the ordinary cosmic radiation. So far as we know, as is known to me, there has never before been recorded so great an increase of cosmic rays which has extended for such a length of time. The kind of work he did demanded the meticulous analysis of a great amount of numerical data, of which Duperrier was a great expert. To facilitate his work, he pioneered the use of business accounting machines for the analysis of cosmic ray data. By 1945, the results obtained by Duperrier were interesting enough so that the Physical Society of London invited him to deliver the 29th Guthrie lecture. That annual lecture has been established in 1914 to honor the memory of the founder of the society, this Frederick Guthrie. And in 1966, he was replaced by the Guthrie Medal and Prize, and in 2008, renamed the Faraday Medal and Prize. This is the letter that the Physical Society, with the Physical Society, invited to Berlin. The list of Guthrie lectures was inaugurated by the American Robert William Good, and among the physicists who followed him were Orban Jebar in 1916, Michelson 1921, Bohr, Niels Bohr 22, Rutherford 27, J.J. Thomson, Max Planck, Compton in 1935, and Patrick Blackett, who obviously was the man who recommended Duperrier, Blackett in 1914. Duperrier delivered the lecture on the 5th of July, choosing as title the geophysical aspect of cosmic ray. Among some of his conclusions, he stated that when smaller changes in cosmic ray intensity, which cannot be explained as being due to meteorological influence are considered, the observations made in London show that there are also more or less closely associated with variation of the geomagnetic field. This fluctuation generally occurs simultaneously with or within a short time of the fluctuation of the magnetic field of the Earth. He argued also that the fluctuation in cosmic ray intensity takes place simultaneously all over the world. To account for this worldwide variation, Duperrier pointed out, some investigators think that they may result from the formation of fundamental alteration of the system of westward currents concentric with the Earth, following in the high ionosphere or in the outer space, due to the emission of electric particles from the Sun at the time of the geomagnetic disturbances. The magnetic field of this current system superposed on the Earth pole will give rise to a decrease of the magnetic force in the region inside and to increase outside the current. Then, the number of incoming particles reaching the Earth may be reduced according to the theory which mentioned yesterday. Professor Peralta just mentioned too, the theory of the metapaillarda and the main phase of the phenomenon, particularly in the case of magnetic storm, will be explained. Another indication of the prestige he was getting by then in England is that soon after the atomic bomb was dropped in Hiroshima, the BBC asked Duperrier to explain something about the scientific fundamentals of the new weapon. It is interesting to point out that during the years he worked in England, Duperrier was constantly in contact with Blackett, a contact which facilitated. There are examples, a letter from Duperrier to Blackett, a contact, I was saying, which facilitated his immersion in the international scientific community. Here you have an example of a letter which Blackett sent to a New Zealander physicist who was working on a magnetic survey of the coast of New Zealand, recommending to take into account some of Duperrier results. Even he was successful in his work on cosmic rays, Duperrier did not have a permanent position in England. To return to Spain was a possibility, but not in the near future, for obvious political reasons. 8 years after the end of the Spanish Civil War, Duperrier mentioned the question in a letter he sent to Blackett from Imperial College. The letter is do not think Franco's last move will affect my position for the present at least. Consequently, following your advice, I shall apply for an ICI fellowship in the course of a few days. However, as it turned out, for another letter to Blackett a couple of months later, he got a different fellowship. Dear Blackett, I am sorry to not to have seen you before this, but I hope that you will come and have lunch or supper with us soon. I wrote to the register accepting the date suggested September 29th for my taking up the Turner and Newell Fellowship. With that support, he continued his investigation, but based now in Bibbet College, to which he moved soon after the end of the year. It is relevant to remember that Blackett was there at Bibbet between 1933 and 1937, and that he was there where he had begun his research on cosmic rays. Duperrier focuses at Bibbet, Duperrier focuses on the intensity of mesons at the surface of the Earth. So in a paper that appeared in the Proceedings of the Physical Society in 1949, he stated, the results show that the temperature appears to be a factor closely controlling the meson intensity at the surface of the Earth. The intensity increases with increasing temperature at the rate of 0.12 per year, per 10 per centigrade degree. Other factors determining the intensity are the mass of air at the height of the 100 millimass. The year this note, he developed those aspects in a note published in Nature in 1951. It was entitled Temperature of the Upper Atmosphere and Meson Production. The year 1951, this note appeared in Nature, was the year Duperrier returned to Spain. This is my late. Tiberius Square. The process that ended with his return began when the Spanish ambassador in London wrote to Perrier on May 3, 1915, transmitting an invitation for the Consejo Superior de Investigaciones Científicas, the High Board of Scientific Research, to deliver a course about cosmic rays. He accepted. It was the first step to his definite return to Madrid as professor at the Faculty of Science in 1953. He was favored by a finally short, very short, moment of liberalization of the Spanish university. His British colleagues, well, this is in Duperrier at his native town. His British colleagues reacted helping him in the best imaginable way. Here is the text of a letter that Blackett sent him on October 22, 1953. Dear Professor Duperrier, I am writing to inform you that the Department of Scientific and Industrial Research has authorized me to make you a long period of 2 years in the first system. They said, which has been in operation in recent years in Manchester, is the property of the Department of Scientific and Industrial Research. The loan is to you is made in order that you should be enabled to carry out further experiments on recording of X-rays in Madrid. We have in mind both the interest of having cosmic ray recording carried out at a fresh site, where the meteorological and other conditions are different, and the great expectation that you, with your great experience on the analysis of the data, may well make a further contribution of importance to the subject. It was a moving act of generosity in the best spirit of science, understood as an international enterprise. An initiative made by a man who was a fierce blacket, who was a fierce opponent to the political regime that ruled in Spain, that of General Franco. As the following anecdote revealed, in 1969, by now, of course, Duperrier was dead, The president of the Spanish Royal Academy of Science wrote blanket, offering him to be named corresponding member of the Spanish Academy. On October 12, 1969, Blackett answered, "I am very much aware of the honor that the Academy wishes to confer on me, but I am sure that you will understand the reason why at the present time I could not accept it." Unfortunately, the instruments that so generously offered Blackett and the Department of Scientific and Industrial Research were kept at the Spanish Customs Office at Bilbao during several years, because Madrid University did not want to pay the import duties. And not only for that, there were many who were not happy at all that Tuperier had returned to Madrid, to Spain. Only in 1958, 5 years after having arrived in Bilbao, the instruments arrived to Madrid. It was too late, as Duperier died the next year. So even he participated in a couple of international congresses dedicated to Scottish race, Guanajuato in Mexico in 1955, Edinburgh in 1958. His scientific life ended when he left